Chapter 11, we're continuing on this theme of the mystery of Babylon, the day of the Lord, the restoration of the people of Israel, and the calling up of the church is kind of emerging as one of the themes as the Spirit of God continues to reveal to us more about the things that we need to be readily tuned into to perceive what God wants us to know at this time in the church. In Genesis chapter 11, and I'm going to start in verse 1. Well, I'll just say this. Noah in verse 8, after he comes out of the ark, says, "Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took of every clean animal and of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar." This is faith at work. It is holy, it is pure, represented in the fact that he did exactly what God said. And then the Lord smelled this soothing aroma, and then he said in his heart, "I will never again curse the ground for man's sake. Although the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth, nor will I ever again destroy every living thing as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, winter and summer, and day and night shall not cease." So God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth." Now, we go to Genesis chapter 11 and verse 1. Remember, the Lord says, "I know that man's intentions of his heart are evil from his youth." God has given a very simple commandment, and that commandment is to be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth. Humans all over the globe. That was the intention of the Lord's heart. Fill up my earth. Inhabit and continue to move out. And sometimes we don't understand, you know, in our own family, some of our ancestors, obviously, most of us that live in America, our ancestors aren't from here. And they basically obeyed the ordinance of Noah and the covenant God made with Noah, that he would again curse the ground, never again destroy the earth. So until the end of the age. "Now the whole earth had one language," Genesis 11:1, "and one speech." Why would they have multiple? Because Noah and his family all communicated, his three sons and their wives. So it would stay together as it was on the ark, so it was as they went out from the ark. Okay, now what did they do with this unity or this common language? "And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar." There's something about the land of Shinar that has attracted their attention and has put something in their heart that says, "Hey, let's just stop right here and let's build something up. Let's build a tower." It says that they dwelt there. "Then, after dwelling there, they said to one another, bake them thoroughly. They had brick for stone, and they had asphalt for mortar. And they said," verse 4, "come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth." In the community that was gathering there in the plain of Shinar, a spirit aroused in them that motivated them to stay there, and instead of going out all over the face of the earth, they decided to go up into the heavens. For what purpose? To make a name for themselves. This was the purpose of their heart. They did not want to obey the Lord because it says, lest we be scattered. The Lord, they put a twist on it. The Lord says, fill the earth. And they said, we don't want to scatter all over the earth. And the Lord's saying, go out and fulfill this word that I've given to Noah and his sons and their sons and their sons. Rather than look at it positively, they look at it as a negative. We're being scattered and separated. And that's what we've had to deal with in our own family. When we moved here to Pala Mountain, you know, the sense for me was, hey, this is normal fare for our family all the way back to when they came here from Germany. And some came from Sweden and some came from Scotland. Well, and my wife's side of the family, they came from Holland. Even her grandfather came here and her grandmother on her father's side. Early 1900s, they came here. Well, why would you just stay in the same spot? See, let us make a name for ourselves. The mindset is stay in one spot. Now, it's one thing if you are being tortured outside. Everywhere you go, there's persecution, worldwide persecution, as we're heading into. And you have to come together to survive. This is different. There's no persecution. You got the whole earth. You can just go enjoy. And instead of going out and spreading and families going out and spread joy in God's earth and enjoying God's relation, the relationship with the Creator, and then in the going, building and spreading yourself, basically, if you have children, when your children go out, you're going out with them. And then they go out from there, and it just, you become part of this Adamic way that God created. But the Lord came down to see the city. Notice that when man starts to lift up to heaven, it gets the attention of Almighty God, and God comes down. And when we turn to Revelation, the exact same thing happens. And when we look at all of redemptive history from here in Genesis chapter 11, well, even take Noah, God came down with a flood. And he gave Noah a supernatural blueprint to save himself. He came down and downloaded all that detail into Noah to preserve him. Why? Because man's heart was violent and evil and selfish and very cruel, murdering spirit was everywhere. And so here, it's not a murdering spirit, it's a false pride and unity that is causing man to go up. If you study you will see a picture of their parliamentary building where they gather, and it's erected, many people believe, and I think it's even understood, that in order with the Tower of Babel, it's incomplete, just like the Tower of Babel was incomplete. And they want to, as it were, incomplete it. What is the purpose of the EU? Is to come together and to make a name for itself. If you're Swedish or English or Italian or Portuguese or Spanish, or Dutch, you have to release your name and take on the name of the EU. And even in our own America, each state, you know, we've lost over the course of the last 200 years, a Virginian was a certain type of person. Now with all the movement, you know, we're under United States. And we came together to be a world empire. It was God's will. But you see, the pride was in it. It's pride that wants you to be a world empire, to have dominance over other nations. That's pride. He's going to deal with pride, always. So in the end, what's God dealing with? It's sorceries, it's lying signs and wonders, it's a false unity created by the Antichrist, and all of this is manifested in the pride of man. And God comes down because he's had enough. Fallen is Babylon, for the earth, the kings of the earth have drunk of her immoralities, out of her golden, beautiful cup, this adorned cup. But inside, what is inside this cup? It's the fierceness of God's wrath, which is the blood of the saints, because out of their pride and their arrogance, they don't understand the way that Jesus has commanded us to walk. This cross-bearing way, this simple life that Jesus established in that first century church of sharing, selling all you have, coming together to the apostles. And the apostles didn't even own it. You know, this is something I like to tell people. I said, you know, these are, you know, people that operate in the apostolic and they operate in the management of a lot of big stuff and they want to be impressive. That's not the spirit of Peter and James and John. Because when they went to the Gate Beautiful and they told that man who was, they said, silver and gold we do not possess. They didn't have any money, but they did, because all the people brought their land and the sale of their land, they laid it at their feet. They laid it at their feet. But they didn't possess that money. That money belonged to God, and it belonged to the people of God to do whatever it was supposed to do to further the kingdom of God. That's the idea. And it's got to be restored. And it will be restored by this refining fire that's coming. Because when the Lord comes down, look what he does. He saw the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, indeed, the people are one, and they have all one language. And this is what they began to do. Now, nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. I want you to know something. Man has power. Just because you have money is not a sign that God is with you. And just because you have a big building, an impressive building, everybody says, wow, that's really great, or a lot of people in your church, does not mean that God is with you. Man has power. And until God comes down and deals with you and busts you up, you don't really know where God is. That's true of my life. I think if you go out there and you pull people who've had a lot and then lost it all, that after they lose it all, they feel like they found God because they got lost in who they were. They thought they were something. They thought they had control of their life. They managed their time and their money with their own will. And that's what was going on in Shinar. He says nothing they propose to do will be withheld from them, because God gave that to man, the power, the image-bearing side. God, image-bearing side of man, has power. Man has lots of power, and we're going to see that power on display in the future. Come, he says in verse 7, God said, let us make man in our image. Here he says, come, let us go down and there confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. How does God do that? How does the Father, the Son, the Word has not become flesh yet, the Word and the Spirit do that? And does he still do it today? Does he create discord? Does he allow things to fall apart? Does he allow people not to understand what you're saying and cause them to leave? Does God teach you things by this? This is the Lord's way. So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of the earth. Here, the word scattered is used again, not filled, because of disobedience, and it was almost like a foreshadowing by the dwellers of Shinar to say, we do not want to be scattered. It was like they knew the mandate, and they knew that if they didn't obey the mandate, that they would be scattered. So indeed, the Lord scatters them abroad from there over the whole face of the earth, and they cease to build the city. Like I said, there's an effort right now to rebuild. And the EU, and he says, from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth. And that is the genesis of Babel and Babylon. Babylon, son of Bel. And this is referred to in the prophets. Now, overview. Nebuchadnezzar was given a dream. And in that dream he saw an image with a gold head. With counsel and wisdom, Daniel answered Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, who had gone out to kill the wise man of Babylon. And he answered and said to Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree from the king so urgent? Then Arioch made the decision known to Daniel. So Daniel went in and asked the king to give him time, that he might tell the king the interpretation. Then Daniel went to his house and made it known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they might seek mercies from the God of heaven concerning the secret. Do you realize that everything that we're talking about, Day of the Lord, Mystery of Babylon, Mystery of the Lost One, everything I've been referring to is a secret. And we are to understand it only in the Spirit. This is proof of it right here, that prayer brought the revelation. Prayer, fasting, seeking the Lord, the God of heaven, His mercy is what granted unto Daniel the interpretation. Then the secret was revealed to Daniel in a night vision. So Daniel blessed the God of heaven. And Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are His." Always. Wisdom and might belong to God, not man. We got a dose, but we don't have all wisdom and all might, all power. And He changes the times and the seasons. Who changes the times and seasons? God. He removes kings and raises up kings. He puts Bush in, then He puts Obama in. He put the father Bush in, then He put Clinton in. He put the son Bush in. These are things that God does. He put Saddam Hussein in, then He took Saddam Hussein out. He put Idi Amin in, then He took him out. He put Tony Blair in, now He's got a new guy in. God is bringing him in and He's bringing him out. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. He reveals deep and secret things. This is God. Only God can do that. He knows what is in the dark, in the darkness. And light dwells with God. Light, real light, true light is only found in God. When the angel of light, Satan, comes, it's false light. False light. I thank You and praise You, O God of my fathers, that You have given me wisdom and might and have now made known to me what we ask of You. If you ask of the Lord what's really going on and you go to this Bible with a fresh attitude and with a seeking heart, humble, broken, God, please show me Your truth. Show it to me so that I may be able to discern the times, to understand the seasons, to cooperate with Your heavenly will. God will give it to you. He will give it to you. I am telling you today, He will give it to you. Therefore, Daniel went to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and said thus to him, "Do not destroy the wise men of Babylon. Take me before the king, and I will tell the king the interpretation." Then Arioch quickly brought Daniel before the king and said thus to him, "I have found a man of the captives of Judah." Okay. How did Nebuchadnezzar come into power? God raised him up to come against Israel and the fact that she was disobedient to the Mosaic covenant. She broke the law of God. And God's patience wore out. And somewhere around 586 BC, she was broken into. And it started in 605, and then over the course of years, eventually Babylon destroyed Israel, Jerusalem, Judah, and carried away just a few. And Daniel, as a young man with his friends, these young Jewish, brilliantly trained young men, the king desired to have them in his court. And so they were then installed in the court of the king of Nebuchadnezzar, King Nebuchadnezzar's court. So here we go. You understand, Babylon was used because it wants to kill the anointed. God wants to bring idolatry into Israel. It wants to confuse true, pure worship. It wants to make God's law hard and hateful. And it wants to introduce other gods. And it has a level of power. So much so that the very temple that God had given to Solomon to build, He allows it to be destroyed. There's nothing we have in America in the church that's as sacred as the temple was to the Jews, yet God destroyed it. So what makes us think God can't destroy some denominational structure, bring it down to its knees, and flatten it? And if He does so, He does it for good, not for evil. God never flattens something. We're going to read this later in Zechariah, yet to restore it. God has a plan of restoration. When with the flood, it was to restore, to cleanse it with the water, to wash it all clean again, get rid of all the sin, which was in man, not in the animals, but in man was sin, and God kills it all, and He starts with Noah afresh. But it doesn't take long before sin enters in. And it doesn't take long to when Moses takes the people out from Egypt, after they see this mighty sign of the red opening, that they fall into idolatry with the golden calf. Sin is always lurking at the door of your church in your life. Sin is always there to break in and cause confusion and take you away from your God-ordained purposes. And Arioch quickly brought Daniel before the king and said thus to him, I have found a man of the captives of Judah who will make known to the king the interpretation. The king answered and said to Daniel, whose name was Belshazzar, are you able to make known to me the dream which I have seen and its interpretation? Are you able to know a dream that I didn't tell you because I killed all these other guys because they couldn't tell me the dream that I didn't tell them? Kind of mean. But see, God wants to show off here. And God's going to show off with his humble servant, Daniel. But there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets. Daniel answered in the presence of the king. The secret which the king has demanded, the wise men, the astrologers, magicians, and soothsayers cannot declare to the king. In times past, all these guys can do things like that. Once again, interpreting dreams is not just the business of Daniel. It's a business of other people like soothsayers and magicians and tarot card readers and all that, mediums and wizards. That they all can do that. They've been around since the beginning of time. It's not hocus pocus. It's real stuff. Some people do it. It's all phony baloney. But if they're incantating to Satan and they're operating in a satanic way, they can do it. Satan gives them power to do it. But here's what Daniel says in verse 28. But there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. That's important to remember. King Nebuchadnezzar, your dream and the visions upon your head, or in your head, on your bed, were these. As for you, O king, thoughts came to your mind while you were on your bed about what would come to pass after this. And he who reveals secrets has made known to you what will be. But as for me, the secret has not been revealed to me because I have more wisdom than anyone living. But for our sakes, me and my friends, who make known the interpretation to the king, and that you may know the thoughts of your heart, you will behold a great image. Okay, we're going to go to Revelation, where we were yesterday. And the dragon stood on the sand of the seashore. It's Revelation 13:1. And I saw a beast coming out of the sea, having 10 horns and 7 heads, and on his horns were 10 diadems, and on his heads were blasphemous names. And the beast which I saw was like a leopard, and his feet were like those of a bear, and his mouth was like the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his throne and his great authority. You, O king, were watching, and behold, a great image. An image. An idol, but it's great. This great image, whose splendor was excellent, stood before you, and its form was awesome. The image's head was of fine gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. Each of these layers represented kingdoms. The gold represented Babylon, not only in the immediate history of being a world empire, but in the fact that it is the head, it is the greatest. It is still the greatest. Babylon is still the greatest. And then the next was the Medes and the Persians. And that was silver. The belly and the thighs were of bronze. That was Alexander the Great and the Greeks. And then we have the legs of iron, and its feet are partly of iron and partly of clay, representing the Roman Empire. And all this came to pass, and it blows people's minds that Daniel and the king interpreted to detail the next phase of kingdoms. And you watched while a stone was cut out without hands. This is critical to what's next. which struck the image on its feet of iron and clay, and broke them in pieces. This stone is going to strike what? The feet. Then the iron, well, let's just say this. I just want to stop right here. We're going to know, and if you've read this before and prayed over it before, you'll know that this stone represents Jesus and the power of his ministry. That it is not made with hands, it is heavenly. And it has power to break the Roman Empire, right? Well, who killed Jesus? Well, the Jews delivered him over to the Roman Empire, which sanctioned his death. They executed him. But his resurrection power, his ascension on high, his presenting his body a living sacrifice to God, the sprinkling of his blood, and the power of his ministry in the lives of men, the Israel of God, will one day crush the Roman Empire. Has that ever happened? Catholic Church and all that. The Roman Empire has to be rebuilt because Christ has to kill and destroy that empire, wipe it out. And when we get into Revelation, we're going to see that the Roman Empire has a linkage to the harlot, the great harlot, and the beast has a linkage to Babylon, right? The two are the power brokers. Then the iron and the clay and the bronze and the silver and the gold were crushed together. This stone not only is going to crush the Roman Empire, it will crush the entire image and become like chaff from the summer threshing floors. To Revelation chapter 14, verse 14. Then I looked and behold, a white cloud and sitting on the cloud was one like the Son of Man, the stone that was not made with men's hands, having a golden crown, which represents authority, power, absolute. A golden crown on his head and a sharp sickle was in his hand. And another angel out of the temple. Where's the temple? It's up above this white cloud in the glory. It's out of heaven. And his loud voice said to him who sat on the cloud, put your sickle and reap. Put in your sickle and reap, for the hour to reap has come, because the harvest of the earth is ripe. What's making it ripe? Well, what's making it ripe is the quick movement of the beast and the empire that he's creating. The beast is effectively getting the whole world to come after this strong delusion through lying tongue, signs and wonders, through intimidation. This beast and his prophet are taking over the world. So that's a harvest that has to be brought in, and it's going to be brought in by the Son of Man who sits on the white cloud with a golden crown on his head. Then he who sat on the cloud swung his sickle over the earth, and the earth was reaped. And another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, and he also had a sharp sickle. Then another angel, the one power over fire, came out of the altar. Fire, altar, refining, judgment. See, the fire refines, but the fire also judges. And those of us who submitted to the rulership of Jesus Christ have gone into the fire that Jesus has called us to because of the fire baptism, when he gives you the Holy Spirit and you submit to him in every area of your life, he gives you the fire. That's the passion and the burning that has been here since the beginning of time in his people, those who are called to war for his cause on the earth. So we go into the fire trial, or our death, or our judgment. And so the fire that we go through refines us so that we can face the Lord without shame, knowing that we have done what he has called us to do. And this angel, he called to a loud voice to him who had the sharp sickle, saying, put in your sharp sickle and gather the clusters from the vine of the earth, because her grapes are ripe. What are these clusters and what are the grapes of the earth? It's these lies and these deceptions, and it's the work of the beast. So the angel swung his sickle to the earth and gathered the clusters from the vine of the earth and threw them into the great winepress of the wrath of God. Do you remember when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he had to drink something he didn't want to drink? Lord, he said, take this cup from me if it's possible. I do not want to drink, only thy will be done. And when Jesus was faced to drink the cup of God's wrath, this is what he drank. He brought into his heart, into his system, the horrors of our sin. Every violation of God's law, to the worst degree, he drank. And verse 20 says of Revelation 14, and the winepress was trodden outside the city, and blood came out from the winepress up to the horses' bridles for a distance of 200 miles. We won't get into the fact that in the end, you know, whether it'll be horses or not. That's always a question. It's my question. It's a natural question. If you're writing this Bible, most of human history doesn't know about missiles and tanks and cars and airplanes and all that. Rockets, satellites. So when they see something, horses or bridles of horses, they might see something that God is showing them is of that time and of that most of human history. But in reality, a horse could be a tank. It could be. I mean, because you got to understand, most of human history is reading this with horses in their culture as the tractor or as the means of transportation. A horse and a ship. So that's what the Bible deals with. And that's another thing about interpretation of Scripture is you got to understand the writer's culture. Yes, he could speak things that we can say, well, he saw, space travel with this one reference in Obadiah or something like that. But most of the time, the Bible's going to deal with it as can be understood. The Lord doesn't hide. His word is to be understood. And I'm trying to make it understood. That's the burden of my heart. And this wine press represents the horror of the slaughter of God. And it is the very thing that motivates heaven to finally deal, recompense the blood of the saints. It's connected to all the blood of all the prophets, all the destruction that has hit the shores of God's cities and God's people. In Jerusalem, even though the people were sinning, God dealt with them in justice, it's still something he's going to judge the erring nation, Babylon, for, or Greece, or Rome. He's going to deal with every nation that he allowed to rise up to a place of arrogance and power and come against his people. He will deal with them in short order because the blood, it gets higher and higher and it then releases from heaven. It's like God coming down and confusing their language. God also did this to defend Israel when he caused Gideon to blow his shofar and crashes clay pot and the lamp, and hundreds of thousands of people were confused, and they confused their languages so that they slaughtered each other. This happened several times in the battles of Israel. So the Lord is going to, in the end, when he destroys Babylon and he puts away the harlot, actually through intrigue and through the beast, he's going to do this in a way work. The stone is going to crush these authorities to pieces. And it's going to be like threshing. It's going to be like chaff separating from wheat on a threshing floor. Notice John the Baptist. I just had this pop into my mind. I'm going to take it as an urging from the Spirit. In chapter 1, we have John the Baptist speaking. John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man, capital M, who is preferred before me, for he was before me. What a powerful statement by a human. John the Baptist recognizes the eternal nature of Jesus, who looked like a regular human, but was foretold to the prophets. He understood in the spirit realm that Jesus was special and he was God and he was going to do a job. And he says, Lamb of God, look upon him. And he says, I did not know him, that he should be revealed to Israel. Therefore, I came baptizing with water. John's ministry was repentance, to prepare the way for Jesus to be seen, literally. We have an assignment to do, you next generation prophets and preachers and forerunners, is we have a job to preach repentance and the cleansing away of the sins of the church, the purification of the bride of Christ, to put on a righteous garment so that she looks beautiful once again, so that Jesus can be revealed in the last hour. And I believe we will meet the Lord in the air. I believe when we put on our garments and look pretty, like a man looking at a beautiful bride, he wants to take her and wrap her up in his life, in his arms, and have his marriage feast and have his nuptial relations that signify the culmination and the purpose for the whole process, to be with her forever. That's the desire of Jesus, to be with us forever. And that's what John's ministry was all about, to prepare the way for Jesus to be seen, revealed. So he cleanses, gets the sin out. So when you have all the sin, you can't see Jesus. So the first thing you do is reconcile yourself to Jesus by confession of sin. And I wrote this earlier in the year, the four R's and the progress that they take us through is you have reconciliation. The first step is get reconciled to God, get right with God. Then he will renew you and strengthen you and revive you into the new man. Then you become a follower of Jesus by resting all of your labors and your works at his feet. And then in time, the restoration of you and all of us and the nation of Israel will occur. But this is the process. It's always a process. When a nation goes bad, it has to start with reconciliation, repentance, sackcloth and ashes, a breaking down of one's pride and humbling yourself to the ground, laying before the throne, the awesome throne of God, the thoroughness of his searching eyes, the brightness of his heat, and the brightness of his countenance, all revealed to us that we cannot hide from him. Do not be naked before him in that day. Come with your righteousness on. Come with your acts of repentance. Have your heart turned fully toward him. The only way you're going to be able to meet him. And John bore witness saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen and testified that this is the Son of God. Isaiah's words, which were a voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. That's what we're doing today. That's what we're going to do every day until the day of the Lord. We're going to get there. We're going to talk about the day of the Lord. But right now, we got to understand, going back in time, how all this has to fit the whole revelation of redemption. We have to understand from the word of God and history of man and God's plan to save man, that everything that is going to happen is going to connect to what has happened. That's very critical. It has to fit into the whole. If it doesn't fit into the whole, you can just spit it out and reject it. I'm telling you that. You can reject anything I say if it doesn't fit in the context of all of Scripture. Then you can just dump it. And I won't be offended because I may in my flesh, but if I'm honest with myself, if I have not preached the truth and it's not matching up with this word, reject it. That would be a good thing for you. Every valley will be filled and every mountain and hill will be brought low. The crooked places will be made straight and the rough ways smooth. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God. It's a worldwide event. Jesus is about the world, starting in Israel, starting with his own, starting with the Jews. Of Luke 3, he says, now even the axe is laid at the root of the tree. of the trees, of the true olive tree, the Jewish blessings of the oracles of God and the covenants, all the promises, all the blessings that Paul talks about in Romans chapter 9 that were given to the Jews as stewardship. And we too today, the church, Jesus Christ in America, the power of the preaching, the history of America, the blessings that we've experienced. Is it the case that the axe is laid at our root? Brood of vipers, therefore bear fruit worthy of repentance. And do not say to yourself, we have Abraham as our father, for I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. Your traditional beliefs and your connection to some king of England or a pope or some pastor or some doctorate in theology has no bearing on God's estimate of who you are. And these Pharisees were laying stock and investing all their hope in their mission with the temple and being keepers of the law of Moses. And God said, I don't even need a human. I can raise up out of stones. I created you out of dirt. I can raise up out of stones people who will worship me. And even now the axe is laid. Therefore, every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. And it says in verse 16, John answered and said to all, indeed, I baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand. Whew! And he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor. Do you get the word thorough? Thoroughly clean his church, his bride. He's going to thoroughly cleanse everything that's going on in the church. He's going to baptize you with the Spirit and with fire. There's no other way to break this text down than to recognize that Jesus has a purpose. And that purpose is to pour his fire into your bosom and you from the inside out. That's the purpose of our Lord Jesus Christ. As much as we want to make him into the most compassionate human that ever lived, he is. As much as we want to say he's the nicest guy, in certain ways he is. But in other ways, he's fierce in his love. He's relentless in his pursuit of holiness and of your affection. He is a jealous God and a jealous Christ and a lamb who has a lion inside of his bosom. He will wreck you and destroy you if you mess with his love, if you trifle with him. He's dangerous, because he will thresh thoroughly his floor and gather the wheat into his barn in heaven. But the chaff will burn with unquenchable fire. And with many other exhortations, he preached to the people. That's what it says. Now you go back to Daniel and the interpretation. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, and the silver, and the gold were crushed together and became like chaff from the summer threshing floors. The wind carried them away so that no trace of them was found, and the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. Jesus is going to fill this earth, and Babylon, Medo-Persian, Greek, and Romans, and their empires will know what hit them. It is Jesus from heaven, enthroned in power with his mighty angels coming with him, who he could have called down at the point of his crucifixion, 10,000 legions, 10,000 times 10,000. He can bring it all down. He could have stopped the crucifixion, but he laid his life down to become our high priest and earn for himself a kingdom that never fades away. This is the dream. Now we will tell the interpretation of it before the king. You, O king, are king of kings, for the God of heaven has given you a kingdom, power, strength, and glory. And wherever the children of men dwell, or the beasts of the field and the birds of the heaven, he has given them into your hand. Babylon, just because you have power doesn't mean that you have the power in and of yourself. God gave you the power. God gave you that kind of regal glory and beauty and majesty, and gave you that intellect, that understanding, that technology, that viperous smooth tongue. God gave it to you. God created Satan. God was a beautiful angel. And he gave you this power. Turn with me to Isaiah. Here's where we have the fall. In this section, we have the fall of Satan. But where does Satan like to hang out? That's the question. The empire, Satan. The burden against Babylon, which Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw. Lift up a banner on the high mountain. Raise your voice to them. Wave your hand that they may enter the gates of the nobles. I have commanded my sanctified ones. I have called also for my mighty ones for my anger, those who rejoice in my exaltation. Who are these mighty ones? Are these the angels in Revelation 13, 14? Are they the ones going to administrate that bold judgment, the wrath of God that's going to be poured out on the beast, which represents Babylon, the mystery, the great, the harlot, representing Rome, and all of her sorceries and all of her deceptions? See, you have to understand that God has to restore Israel, because Israel was defeated, which was God's people. God, to be God, he has to bring back that which was done. Though it would appear that she would be forever lost, I think it's going to say it in Zechariah, which I want to get to, because I'm going to deal with the day of the Lord in Zechariah. It's very, very powerful. Zechariah is an end unto itself. It has so much packed into it. And you go to Joel chapter 2, and it talks about this terrible day of the Lord, this day of doom and darkness. The mountains are turning dark with these thick clouds of judgment, and this mighty army is raised up. And it ties also to an event that has not yet occurred, because it says in there that it's never been done before for many successive generations. Joel chapter 2, read the first few verses. And here, back to Isaiah 13. Wail, for the day of the Lord is at hand. He says in verse 5, to destroy the whole land. Verse 6, wail, for the day of the Lord is at hand. It will come as destruction from the Almighty, directly from the Almighty. Therefore, all hands will be limp, every man's heart will melt, and they will be afraid. Pangs and sorrows will take hold of them. And he's talking to Babylon here, which hasn't happened yet. They will be in pain as a woman in childbirth. They will be amazed at one another. Their faces will be like flames. Behold, the day of the Lord comes, cruel with both wrath and fierce anger, to lay the land desolate. He will destroy the sinners from it. For the stars of heaven, check this out, I looked, Revelation 14, 1. Behold, the Lamb was standing on Mount Zion in heaven, and with him 144,000, having his name and the name of his Father written on their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven saying, the sound which was like many waters, the sound of loud thunder, and the voice which I heard was like the sound of harpists playing on their harps. And they sang a new song from the throne of heaven before the four living creatures and the elders, and no one could learn the song except the 144,000 who had been purchased from the earth. These 144,000 have been sanctified and brought up into heavenly places. They are singing from Zion. They're the only ones who have the song understood. To Isaiah 13. He says, he will destroy its sinners from it, for the stars of heaven and their constellations will not give their light. The sun will be dark. The heavens and the earth will move out of her place. And the wrath of the Lord of hosts, and in the day of his fierce anger, it shall be as the hunted gazelle and as a sheep that no man takes up. Every man will turn to his own people, and everyone will flee to his own land. So this Tower of Babel is now being scattered. People are still alive, but man will be rare. There will be a few, just like Noah, that are saved. And everyone who is found will be thrust through, and everyone who is captured will fall by the sword. Their children will be dashed to pieces before their eyes. Their houses will be plundered and their wives ravaged. Behold, I will stir up the Medes against them who will not regard silver. And as for gold, they will not delight in it. This happened. The Babylonian Empire went down to the Medes and the Persians. But it is spiritually spoken, because he says in verse 20, and Babylon, the glory of the kingdoms, 19, the beauty of the Chaldeans' pride, will be as when God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. There's nothing there anymore. It's destroyed forever. Sodom and Gomorrah is where the salt sea is. You can't grow anything there. The salt is in the water, and you can actually float. 38% of it's salt. You can do stuff for your skin, lotions, and all this stuff. But anyway, verse 20 says, it will never be inhabited, nor be settled from generation to generation, nor will the Arabian pitch tents there, nor will the shepherds make their sheepfolds there, but wild beasts of the desert will lie there. And their houses will be full of owls, ostriches will dwell there, wild goats, hyenas will howl in their citadels, and jackals in their pleasant palaces. Her time is near to come. This is Isaiah chapter 14 says, for the Lord will have mercy on Jacob, and will still choose Israel and settle them in their own land. Now you're writing this to Jews, you're writing this to people who are in the land, people who have not lost it yet, Babylon has not taken it yet, they haven't been brought back yet, like in the time of Zechariah and Haggai, Esther, later on. We are believing here that the Lord's literally talking about the land of Israel. The strangers will be joined with them, and they will cling to the house of Jacob. Strangers, who are they? Could be Gentiles, believing Gentiles who love Israel, are joining with them. Then the people will take them and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel will possess them for servants, maids in the land of the Lord. They will take them captive, whose captives they were, and rule over them who oppress them, their oppressors. And it shall come to pass in the day of the Lord, when he gives you rest from your sorrow and from your fear and the hard bondage in which you were made to serve, that you will take up this proverb against the king of Babylon and say, how the oppressor has ceased, the golden city ceased. Shinar and its gold, the gold of Ophir and all the glory of Babylon has ceased. The Lord has broken the staff of the wicked, the scepter of rulers. He has struck the people in wrath with a continual stroke. He who ruled the nations in anger is persecuted, and no one hinders. The whole earth is at rest and quiet. They break forth into singing. Indeed, the cypress trees rejoice over you, and the cedars of Lebanon singing, since you were cut down, no woodsman has come against us. Hell from beneath is excited about you to meet you at your coming. It stirs up the dead for you, all the chief ones of the earth. Now in verse 12 of Isaiah 14, he talks to Lucifer. He created Lucifer to be beautiful. But listen to what happened. How you were fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you were cut down to the ground. You who weakened the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. The Tower of Babel and desire to ascend into heaven comes directly from Lucifer. Lucifer in a particular people. Anybody who wants to rule the world has the power of Lucifer in their heart. He says, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Arrogance and pride. Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit. Verse 22, for I will rise up against them, says the Lord of hosts. I will cut off from Babylon the name and the remnant. The name of Babylon, taking on the man's name, as it speaks of in Revelation. When people take the mark, they take the mark of his name. He will cut it off. And offspring and posterity, says the Lord, and I will make it a possession for porcupine, marshes of muddy water, and I will sweep it with the broom of destruction. The reaping sickle will wipe away all of its prosperity. Babylon. It's been a lot of jumbled references, but we're dealing with Babylon. We're dealing with the history of Babylon. We're dealing with God's ultimate power over Babylon, that he came down and confused our language. God will continue to come down. We're dealing with John the Baptist and his foretelling of Jesus' ministry. We're taking that forward and saying that's what we're doing again, because the second coming refers to the coming of the Lord. And there's four runners that are going to prophesy and speak forth the return of Jesus, just like Paul was constantly preparing the people for the presence of God, because persecution was coming and it was about in his time. He was executed by Rome. Peter was executed in Rome by Rome. So the hurriedness and the urgency that we are supposed to have right now, intense than ever, because God is in a mood right now to move very quickly. He is going to, he's assessed the nations right now. He's putting his people where he wants to put his people. He's going to connect his people, the ones who are the real remnant, and we will have great fellowship, and we will work together in mighty power, I believe. I don't believe I'm here on this planet to spend the rest of my days in jail. I believe we're going to have some really good times after this flip and transition, where everything is flipped inside out and upside down. We are going to be preserved. We're going to be protected, but we've got to be prepared to handle the glory. We got to be prepared to handle all the weight of God's blessing flowing in us. We got to stand in Christ and only in Christ. We cannot take for ourselves any of the glory. We cannot touch, cannot even touch the glory one little way. God has to be preeminent over all. Okay. And he says in Isaiah 66, heaven is my throne, earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you will build me? And where is the place of my rest? For all those things my hand has made, and all those things, and by those things they exist, by me, says the Lord. But on this one I will look, on him who is poor and of a contrite spirit, and who trembles at my word. In the Beatitudes it says that the meek shall inherit the earth. In the end, when all this judgment is being poured out in heaven, we are there. If we're alive on the earth, we're here for all of the destruction of Babylon. We're going to see it firsthand. Or if we're caught up, we're going to see it from the heavens. But it's the meek that get what's left of the earth. After it's destroyed by fire, refined by fire, as judgment falls on it, all the wealth of the nations will be destroyed, and then the meek will inherit the earth. Those who tremble at the word of God, that is what God is preparing the earth for, the meek. So we need to come into a state of meekness. Get the pride and the arrogance out of our ministries and move into meekness. And God will bless us and exalt us. He says, those who humble themselves will be exalted, and those who exalt themselves, he will abase. So that's what I have to say, and pray that God will make sense of it all.